church. Let's try that again. Good morning, church.
Good morning.
Good morning. What a great day it is to be in the house of the Lord. Amen?
Amen.
Amen. So good to see you all here. You are our guest with us. We just want to say thank you so much for joining us this morning. In the bulletin, you'll notice there's a connection card. If you would, please fill that out for us. We'd love to follow up with you and get to know you. We just so appreciate you again joining us today. I have a few updates for you, church family, just for you to be praying for. If you haven't heard, please be praying for Charlene. As many of you know, this next last Thursday, the 23rd, our brother Norman, he went to go be with the Lord. So please just keep praying for Charlene and for the family. As far as for services for Norman, they'll be held here at DWMBC this coming Thursday at 11 a.m. But due to the COVID-19 situation we're in, we're asking just for family to come and attend. However, we will be live streaming that service on our Facebook page. So you can join us at 11 on the Facebook page or later in the day with the replay. So please join us as we celebrate Norman's life. And please be praying for Charlene and for her whole family as well. I know she so appreciates all the prayers and all the thoughtful messages already, with many of you reaching out to her.
Sam, also John Hart.
I'm about to hit that.
Oh,
yes,
okay.
Thank you.
Okay.
And then for our second, we have John Hart. And he's in the Huntsville Hospital right now. So please be praying for him. He has pneumonia, okay? So be praying for him today and for Maxine as well, okay? So a few updates for you to just be praying for them. Also, if you will have any other prayer needs, I know a lot's happening in your lives too, please take that connection card, right? Your prayer needs or your praises on that connection card, you can turn them into the offering plates. And you can always reach out to our church office. If you're not getting our weekly email updates from us, please give us your email. Again, you can write that on that connection card, or you can contact our church office. We still have quite a few of these in the back. If you didn't have a chance last week to grab them, these are your invited to church card. It has our live stream information on the back as well, and our new service time. So grab a few of these on your way out today and invite someone to church with you. And then lastly, tomorrow, Monday, is the grocery ministry. And we still need a lot of help. So if you are able and willing to help us out, you can drop off donations from 9 to 10 a.m. Or you can come and help serve by making those food boxes and heading out from 1 to 3 to deliver. If you have any questions about the grocery ministry, please don't hesitate to reach out to us. We just appreciate all your support with that. All right, let's go ahead and go to the Lord in prayer. Heavenly Father, we do just thank you for another day that you have blessed us with, Lord. Father, we thank you for your church here at Dorcas Wills and just the opportunities you have given us to serve you, to be your hands and your feet. Lord, I thank you for all my brothers and sisters who are joining us in person today and some who are joining us live. We just thank you for them and ask you to continue, Lord, to work in their lives in a mighty way, that they would continue to seek you each and every day. Lord, we do just lift up Charlene to you this morning and her family. Lord, we thank you that Norman is with you. We rejoice in the salvation that he has through your son, Jesus Christ, Lord. And we thank you for his faithful life to you. Lord, I just pray for Charlene, for the family, Lord, that you would bless them. Lord, that you would overwhelm them with your love, with your peace, that you would give them strength, Father. Lord, we do, Lord, just lift up John to you as well today, Lord. I know he is struggling in the hospital. We pray for your healing hand to touch him, Father. And just for your peace that surpasses all understanding to overwhelm Maxine right now. Lord, please be with them. Guide the hands of the doctors, Lord, and of the physicians. Lord, again, we just thank you for this day. We thank you for this time that we have now to worship you in praise and song. And through the studying of your word, Lord, please be with Brother Mark, be with the worship team today as they lead us in worship. Father, please be with Pastor Gray. I know you have put this message on his heart today, Lord. Please speak through him with your spirit. Lord, may we open our ears and hear what we need to hear and change and apply it, Lord, to our hearts and our lives. Again, we love you, we praise you, we ask you that you help us to be your hands and your feet. And we ask these things in Jesus' name. Amen.
Great to be back, and I just am so thankful for the time off, but God is good. He has protected us as we traveled, and we are just so thankful for Jeff for stepping in and doing such a great job last week. I just want to encourage you now this morning. In our life, the one thing that we should do is to glorify the Lord in all things. And so this is what this song is about, and as we glorify Him this morning, let's stand together. Glory to God forever.
Before the world was made, before you spoke, before
Oh,
continue. Worthy is the Lamb. Thank you for the cross, Lord.
Every God. morning.
Good morning.
Good morning. Good to see all of you here, plus our those of you joining us on live stream. I was just thinking about something. Why can I not get around and say hello to everybody on Sunday mornings? And then I thought, well, you know, normally we have Sunday school and early service and lots of time. And I have a couple hours to say hello to everybody, but I know that I have not said hello to everybody here yet. So this is my opportunity. Good morning. Good to see you. If I didn't speak to you personally, it's not because I was trying to avoid you. Except that your name is Dallas. I'll put down where you're at. She is one I spoke to. Also, we have a birthday here today. Whoop. Right. We have any birthdays here today? Anybody wearing red having a birthday today? Anybody wearing red and have a flower on their shirt having a birthday today? Anybody turning red in your face having a birthday today? Chris has a birthday today. Happy birthday, Chris. Well, open your Bibles with me. We're in Matthew chapter 7, looking at verses 15 through 20. Matthew 7, verses 15 through 20. If you are able, please stand with me as we read together. If you do not have a Bible handy, we do have words printed on the screen for those of you here in service with us. Beware of false prophets who come to you in sheep's clothing, but inwardly are ravenous wolves. You will recognize them by their fruits. Are grapes gathered from thorn bushes? Are figs from thistles? So every healthy tree bears good fruit, but the diseased tree bears bad fruit. A healthy tree cannot bear bad fruit, nor can a diseased tree bear good fruit. Every tree that does not bear good fruit is cut down and thrown into the fire. Thus, you will recognize them by their fruits. Let's pray together. Lord, we are grateful for your word. We thank you so much for the opportunity that you give us to gather, to lift our voices in worship, to study your word. Lord, we know that your word is truth.
Amen.
And Lord, as we look upon these words, there's difficult teaching for us to hear. But let us not shy away, but be convicted by your word. And Lord, I pray too that as we gather together, there are so many times when we do not speak our needs to others. We allow Satan to get a foothold in our lives, thinking others don't care about us when they really don't know our needs. Lord, especially during this time of separation and distancing, let us continue to reach out to one another. Let us continue to let our needs be known that we might be ministered to, prayed for. Lord, I pray your conviction, your spirit to move here today amongst each one of us. In Jesus' name I pray. Amen.
Amen.
Good to see you. Hey, good news from the early service today. We did have a young lady to desire to unite with our church fellowship and we'll baptize her at some point. That's really exciting. Just glad to share that news with you, and the Lord is working in hearts here, even during this time we're dealing with COVID. God's word is alive. Amen.
Amen. Amen.
Well, there's a story told about a good citizen who was driving down the road. He was being tailgated by someone who was very impatient. As he drove along, he was obeying the speed limits, and he came upon a stoplight. You can see up ahead it was green, but as he got closer, it turned amber, right in time for him to stop. He could have gunned his car and got through, but he decided to stop, play it safe. And as he stopped, the person behind came up, almost crashing into the back of his car, and it was a lady, and she was not happy that this man had stopped. And she began to be on her steering wheel. She began to flash him signs with her fingers. She began to yell and curse. And right about that time, she heard a knock on her window. It was a police officer. And he's like, "Man, get out of that car." And she got there and said, "Put your hands up." And he actually handcuffed her, took her to the local jail, and began to question her and finally putting her in a cell. Little time had passed when the police chief came down and he released her from the cell and brought her back to the arresting officer, the booking area. And the booking officer said to her, "I'm sorry for my mistake." He said, "You see, I pulled up behind your car while you were blowing your horn, while you were waving and cursing at the person in front of you and shouting obscenities. You were going that way just crazily. And I looked in the back of your car and I saw a Choose Life license plate holder. And I saw a bumper sticker that said, 'What would Jesus do?' And I saw another bumper sticker that said, 'Follow me to Sunday school.' And then I saw a chrome-plated Christian fish emblem on the truck." He said, "Naturally, I thought you were stolen a dog." Ouch. Ouch. Sometimes there's a difference between the inside and the outside of a person. Amen? Amen. Sometimes we are not what we claim to be. It could be called hypocrisy. It could be called living falsely or falsely. It's my understanding that many years ago, it was 1979, Bradley, the automotive division of Ford Corporation, sold a fiberglass body that would fit right over a Volkswagen Bug. And this fiberglass body was made to look sleek. It was made to look sporty. And so a person that had a Volkswagen Bug could buy one of these fiberglass molds, put it over top of the car, and go driving around town, and people would think that they were driving a fancy sports car. Yet underneath, it was still just a Volkswagen Bug. That sounds like some people, doesn't it? Showy on the outside, but not so hot on the inside. And that's really what our passage today warns us against. There are people in the world who want nothing more than to deceive us.
Amen.
They want to deceive us. There are people that present themselves as ones who have similar beliefs, similar values and desires. But once they've reeled us in, oftentimes the truth will then come out. But unfortunately, we might have already been sucked into their plan by the time we're aware of what they're doing. Today, this passage warns us to be on guard. And that's our first point. We are told in verse 15 to be alert. Or the word in the ESV is beware, beware. And that's a warning before us. Beware of false prophets. They look harmless, clothed as sheep, but are inwardly as ravenous wolves. Wolves have always been in folklore something that has shown us that. That imagery may or may not be true. But when the wolf is at the door, it is bad news to us, whether you are a pig or a human. A man by the name of Red Foley knew hard times enough. He said this: "The proverbial wolf at the door had a litter of pups on my back porch." And sometimes we feel that way. Wolves are always shown pulling down the very sick, the old, stragglers. In Scripture, wolves are portrayed not in a good light either. And so I will trust the Word of God, because better than any zoologist, the Creator knows the animals in His kingdom. In their defense, I will say that before the fall of man, they were probably not what they are now. And so in a sense, you can blame what they are on us. In our day, wolves can be politicians. They can be leaders. They can be people that are in control of a country. They can be some of the people that have authority over us. In Scripture, Ezekiel was given the charge to tell Jerusalem of their sins and problems. One of the things that he hit on was that her princes were feeding upon the people like wolves on a rampage. Instead of being shepherds that they were supposed to be, they were supposed to be shepherds to protect it and led the people. And yet that's not how they were choosing to lead. To deny that we have such leaders in the country is to be naive, is to be blind to reality. We do have bad politicians. We do have bad judges. We do have bad police officers. We do have bad preachers and teachers. Fortunately, there are some that are good, we're blessed by that, but sadly, they go back. It only takes a few to put this picture upon everyone that you can't trust anyone.
Amen.
Amen.
That's right.
You know, the biggest job of a spiritual shepherd is to keep wolves away from his flock. That's my job, to keep wolves away from the flock that God has trusted to me. And it's not always an easy job, but it is a job that when we depend as a pastor, depend on the Word of God, He does the work. And we just proclaim His truth. Sadly, some of the meanest and toughest wolves often appear with the name of pastor, or reverend, or bishop, or even prophet before their names. You know, Paul writes in the book of Acts, talking about the time when he would depart, and we'll read it in just a moment, but he knew that soon after he left, wolves would gather, those who would be false teachers. Some would be very slick talking or have some sort of pedigree to show, but they would be wolves nonetheless. Wolves do not care for their flock. They only want to take what the flock can give them. You've heard the word fleece. Oftentimes, these false prophets, these wolves, will come and fleece what they can take from their congregation, and then they will leave. And they leave behind, and some of you may have experienced this, under a pastor who was a false prophet, and they leave behind pain, they leave behind disappointment. There are some people who even lose their faith because of what has taken place. Sadly, there might be several women who lose their honor because of this wolf that has been serving them. These wolves will be covered by the blood of the flock, but not by the blood of the Lamb. You know, there's a story that's very popular as a child in our culture, the story of Little Red Riding Hood. And at the end, the wolf pays the price, doesn't it? And there will be a day when wolves who are around us will come into judgment. Amen. They will pay the price for how they have treated others. Recompense will take place for what they've done to the Lord's flock.
Amen.
The sheep will be avenged. We will be avenged. If wolves were something that came to us when they snarl, when they frog at the mouth, it would be easy to recognize them, wouldn't it? They would be known because of their appearance, but they don't do that. They come, we're told, in sheep's clothing. They come at times as angels of light. They speak great, welling words, and they will speak whatever it will take to win your confidence. Some even come with lying wonders. We'll talk about that more in a moment. Yet a casual search of their theology, watching exactly what they teach, reveals the truth. The strong are not taken in by them, but again, the weak, the young, the very sick, stragglers, and maybe even backsliders. These wolves are hungry. Verse 15 uses the word ravenous. That's different from just being hungry, isn't it? It suggests that they will tear into anything. They don't have a discerning appetite. They just have a great appetite. But what are they hungry for? They're not hungry necessarily for food. They're not necessarily hungry for your money. But they're hungry for you. That's what the ravenous wolf desires. Us. And this is the warning in Paul, as I spoke of just a moment ago, in Acts chapter 20. He says, pay careful attention to yourselves and to all the flock in which the Holy Spirit has made you overseers. So who is he talking to? He's talking to people like me and other leaders that would oversee the church. And he said, pay special attention to care for the church, which God obtained with his own blood, the blood of Jesus. Verse 29, I know that after my departure, fierce wolves will come in among you, not sparing the flock. And from among your own selves will arise men speaking twisted things to draw away the disciples after them. Therefore, be alert, remembering that for 3 years I did not cease night or day to admonish everyone with tears. Again, be alert, be awake, be aware of what's going on around you. Wolves desire you because you are their power base. You become their flock. You become their source of power. You validify what they're doing because everyone believes that they got such a large following, they must be saying, they must be doing something right. Jude condemns these devourers. He says in his letter, for certain people have crept in unnoticed who long ago were designated for this condemnation, ungodly people who pervert the grace of our God into sensuality and deny our only Master, Lord Jesus Christ. But these people blaspheme all that they do not understand, and they are destroyed by all that they, like unreasoning animals, understand instinctively. Woe to them, for they walk in the way of Cain. Now listen, these are some examples from the Old Testament. What did Cain do? He killed his brother. They walk in that way, so they're murderers. They abandoned themselves for the sake of gain to Balaam's error. What did Balaam do? Balaam was called to curse the people of God, but what came out? It was all blessing, wasn't it? He couldn't do it. And perish in Korah's rebellion. These are hidden reefs at your love feast, as they feast with you without fear. Shepherds feeding themselves. Look at these next examples. I love their uses. Waterless clouds. What good is a cloud that does not bring a dry land some water? They are swept along by the winds. Fruitless trees in late autumn. When they should be giving fruit, when they give nothing, they are worthless. Twice dead, uprooted, wild waves of the sea, casting up the foam of their own shame. Wandering stars for whom the gloom of utter darkness has been reserved forever. All that is from Jude, verse 4, verse 10, and verses 11 through 13, in case you want to note that. Now, the way that Jude describes these false prophets, these wolves, you'd think that they were some kind of three-headed monster that could be easily identified, but that's not the case. That is not the case at all. They're not. Satan, we're told, appears like an angel of light. Satan and his followers don't hand out calling cards and say, by the way, I'm an enemy of God. Just wanted to let you know. They don't do that. They don't operate that way. They disguise themselves to gain your confidence because it's easier to deceive us when they look like us. And that's the whole point. Some things appear rather harmless at first. They may not be so. I go back to an example. Many years ago, there was an award-winning movie, Brokeback Mountain. Some of you may know exactly what I'm talking about. That's the eyes going up. Right. Well, this movie was touted as like a cowboy, old-fashioned cowboy movie. Later, even Hollywood says it's a love story. But in truth, it was the story of two gay cowboys. But Hollywood says it's a love story. You cannot trust what Hollywood says, nor can you trust a false prophet with your life.
Amen.
Beware. Beware. Number two, be wise. Verses 16 through 18 and verse 20. By their fruit, we are told, you will recognize them. So some questions to ask about these false prophets. One is, do they teach another God? In the Old Testament, God's people were told in Deuteronomy 13, verses 1 through 4, if a prophet or a dreamer of dreams arises among you and gives you a sign or a wonder, and the sign or wonder that he tells you comes to pass, and if he says, let us go after other gods, which you have not known, and let us serve them, you shall not listen to the words of that prophet or that dreamer of dreams. For the Lord your God is testing you to know whether you love the Lord your God with all your heart and with all your soul. You shall walk after the Lord your God and fear him and keep his commandments and obey his voice, and you shall serve him and hold fast to him. You hear these verses, and we're told, in other words, even if a person comes and he can tell you fortune, he can do miraculous things before they come true. If he did cause you to follow another God, he is teaching you falsely. Do not listen to what he teaches. Such a person is a liar. Stay away from them. Second question, do they teach another Jesus? 1 John 2, 22 and 23. Who is the liar but he who denies that Jesus is the Christ? Who is that liar? This is the Antichrist. He who denies the Father and the Son. No one who denies the Son has the Father. Whoever confesses the Son, the Father he also has. Third question, do they teach another gospel? Galatians 1:8. But even if we or an angel from heaven should preach a gospel other than the one we preach to you, let them be under God's curse. Fourth question, do they teach another book? Proverbs 35 and 6, every word of God proves true. He is a shield to those who take refuge in him. Do not add to his words, lest he rebuke you and you be found a liar. I'm going to take you back to June of 2006. The United States Episcopal Church said on that day it had elected its first woman presiding bishop. There was a breakthrough in their eyes after years of resistance in a church already driven by the election of a gay bishop. Catherine Jeffords Story, Bishop of the Episcopal Diocese of Nevada, was elected to serve as the United States Anglican Church's chief pastor and primate at its general convention that year in Columbus, Ohio. She said this, "I am awed and honored and deeply privileged to be elected. May this great and greatly blessed church of ours be the vehicle in building the reign of God in our day." Story, she was 52 at the time. She had a doctorate in oceanography. She worked with the U.S. National Marine Fisheries Service. She's married to a professor of topology. She has a daughter who's an officer in the U.S. Air Force. This is all according to her biography. In a way, I wonder, what does that have to do with spiritual things? But something led into her. But here's what really gets me. She was interviewed at that time by CNN, and she was asked if it was a sin to be a homosexual. And this is what she said, "I don't believe so." Well, she doesn't even have to have a doubt, because Scripture is very clear about that. It isn't about what she believes if she is proclaiming the gospel. She says, "I believe." That is a warning. That is a warning when you hear that. "I believe," not what the Word says, "I believe." She says, "I believe that God creates us with different gifts. Each one of us comes into this world with a different collection of things that challenge us and things that give us joy and allow us to bless the world around us. Some people come into this world with affections ordered toward other people of the same gender, and some people come into this world with affections directed at people of other genders." She says, it's a gift. I disagree, obviously, because of God's Word. Now, I want you to know this. God does not hate us because of our sin. Amen. He does not hate a homosexual because of that sin. Amen. And I'm going to give you a very vivid example. In John chapter 8, there's a woman there who was caught in adultery. It is a sin.
Amen.
She's caught in adultery. And if you remember, there were people there basically with stones in their hands, ready to put this woman to death, ready to kill her. What did Jesus say? "Put the stones down. Put the stones down. Let him who is without sin cast the first stone." Anyway, put the stones down. Why? Because he loved her. He cared about her. In fact, he loved her out of her sin, or at least loved her enough to ask her to leave it behind.
Amen.
But he didn't accept the sin. He accepted her as a person. He did love her.
Amen.
I go on record as saying, and I know you feel the same way, God loves each of us. We are all sinners. Our sins may be different. God has not chosen to say that a homosexual person is a person that can't be loved by him.
Amen.
But he calls that person in the same way as he calls each one of us to leave sin behind.
Amen.
To walk in obedience.
Amen.
I listened yesterday. I was flipping back and forth, and I listened to an old Billy Graham sermon when it was in a crusade. And he went through these three steps, what it means to be a follower of Jesus. And that was the third step, to obey. Live in obedience to the Word of God. That's what sets us apart, that we are reading, hearing, accepting the Word of God, and living by it. Jude 22:23, "Be merciful to those who doubt, snatch others from the fire, and save them. To others show mercy mixed with fear, hating even the clothing stained by corrupted flesh." The Jude is saying that we must demonstrate to one another mercy to those whom we consider to be in sin, and at the same time, push that sin away. Push that sin away. He says, hating even the clothing stained by corrupted flesh. I go back to this example. I'm not saying the bishop's story is a false prophet, but I'm saying to you that her stand on homosexuality is clearly opposed to God's word. We are told, by their fruit you will recognize them. That is false prophets. I just want to say one more thing. Pastors need to be careful. Because if I, as a pastor, make you comfortable in sin, if I, as a pastor, do not warn you when you're sinning that repentance is needed, there's a day when you will stand before the Lord, and if you do not repent of your sin, you will face judgment.
Amen.
Well, what do you think should happen to me? To one who has been given much, much is demanded. I am under the same judgment because I failed to tell the people that God loves that your sin separates you from God.
Amen.
We must repent.
Amen.
We all need to protect ourselves from the false prophets of this world. We must be discerning people. We need to be aware. We need to be wise. Lastly, we need to be informed. Verse 19 tells us that there's an end that awaits. And we're told that every tree that does not bear good fruit, what will happen? It'll be cut down. Okay. The forest is made up of many trees. The church is made up of many people. And I want you to think about this picture. The forest is made up of many trees, but not all those trees are fruit-bearing trees, are they? The church is made up of many people. Are all of them believers?
Amen.
How is one to know? This is sobering. How is one to know that we are a true believer belonging by our fruits? I didn't finish that sentence. People belonging to God by our fruit. Just because a tree is in a forest, it doesn't make it a fruit tree. And just because a person is in a church, it does not mean that they are belonging to Jesus. I'm jumping ahead to next week's sermon, verse 21. Not everyone who says to me, Lord, Lord, will enter the kingdom of heaven. And that's talking about people standing at that point of judgment. Lord, Lord, did we not do this for you? And what does he say? Well, I didn't know you. I didn't know who you were. We've got to be informed. We're told here that judgment will come and it will be harsh. I read that it was a practice of Charlemagne. He was an emperor of the Holy Roman Empire from 800 to 814. And he would force all those that he conquered in battle to become Christians. In fact, if there was a river or a lake or something near the battlefield, he would march these conquered people right through that lake, right through that river to baptize them. But there was, of course, objection to that. But thousands of Saxons were made to profess their Christian faith. Naturally, it did them little good. They didn't know what they were professing. They didn't know who they were following, and they had no desire to accept it. So what Charlemagne did to ease the resistance was to offer anyone who would become a Christian a new white shirt. You think that's not so special? It was to them. They were all given these white shirts if they converted to Christianity. And so numerous were the requests of these shirts that the supply ran out. And the newly baptized people began receiving instead a coarse yellow shirt. It was coarse in its material. The shirt was not so attractive as we can gather from the comments I'm about to share from one who received one of these shirts. This was a Saxon chieftain, and he said this, I have been baptized already 20 times. That tells you something. Was it working? No. I have been baptized already 20 times and received white shirts. I refuse to be baptized anymore and will have nothing to do with a religion that is so stingy with its clothing. You know, it sounds like Charlemagne was arm-twisting people into becoming Christians
and getting baptized.
Do you think it did them any good? Of course not. It did them no good. Forcing people to decide for Christ and confess Christ will do them no good. It will not change their lives. It will not change their standing with God. That is a personal matter. Could it be within the church that some people have confessed Christ but don't really belong to Him?
Okay.
Yes, that is the truth. It's a very good possibility. In ancient China, gin merchants often took on apprentices to study the craft of selecting cutting and even the selling of rare stones. So one young man came to this master craftsman and he said, "Will you take me on as an apprentice?" And the craftsman said, "Yes, come back tomorrow and you can serve under me." When the young man came back, the craftsman handed him a ruby and he sent it to a corner and said, "Sit there and hold the ruby." This went on throughout that day. That's all he did. He did the same the next day and the next day after that. And for 2 weeks, he came in and sat in the corner holding the ruby. And finally, he was so upset and complained and asked, "Why am I being treated this way?" And the craftsman, without a word, placed the stone into the young man's hand. And at which time the apprentice said, "That's not a ruby." He learned to know the authentic from the fake by constant exposure to the real thing. Our question today is, who am I to follow? Who am I to follow? If you're not sure who to follow, immerse yourself in the authentic. Amen. Immerse yourself in the Word of God. Immerse yourself in teaching of the Word of God and that truth.
Amen.
And then you will know who to follow. Let's stand and pray again. Lord, we are grateful for your Word. We thank you for the truths that we learned there. And I pray today that this part of the Sermon on the Mount would touch each one of our listeners here today, whether it be online through the live stream or right here in the sanctuary. Lord, bring us to decision. Particularly, Lord, when we think about the last point of today, about a judgment that awaits. May we look at our lives and look to see if we are having fruit for you. Lord, I pray if as we look, if we don't see fruit, that we would repent, that we would turn to you, that we would ask someone that we trust, what can we do? What shall we do? But the good news right at this moment is that what we do is trust in Jesus. The good news right at this moment is that we have an offer from Jesus, who died on the cross for our sin, who was resurrected to life, who lives in heaven this day, and cares for us, intercedes for us, prays to the Father for us. The good news is we can have a relationship with him if we just accept it. In obedience to Jesus' voice, won't you come to him today? Won't you pray with me right now? Lord Jesus, I know I have sinned. I renounce that sin. I turn from it, Lord. I want to begin living your way. Take my life, Lord. My ears are open to hear. My body, my hands, my feet, my voice, they are all yours. Use me, Lord. I accept the gift of salvation from you. If you pray that prayer, you let someone know. If you are with us in the service today, step out. You can step forward right now and come forward and take Brother Sam's hand and talk about the decision. If you are watching on live stream and God has led you to that decision, call this church. Reach out. And you can get that number online from our website. Let someone minister to you and show you the next step. Lord, we pray for the movement of your Spirit as you have led anyone here to make a decision today. If you've led people here needing prayer and encouragement, give them the courage to step out from where they're standing and share that decision today. We pray together in Jesus' name.
Amen.
As we sing and have our time of response, if you have a decision to make, won't you share that today? We are set up here in the counseling room where we can socially distance, but still encourage you with whatever your need may be. Come today if God accepts you. Thank you. all y'all come up with me. Now, these will be our first new members since we did our COVID time. And so we want to, we're doing something a little different. They're going to stand up here. I'm going to present them first. They're going to stand here. Y'all are going to come by like a little parade. Wave at them and welcome them. This is Steve and Brenda McNeely. They come today desiring to unite with the church family. Upon their statement, they both know Jesus personally. They have been baptized. And they just celebrate the ministry. They've been with us a while. But, God has led them now to unite. They're actually neighbors of my father-in-law and mother-in-law, Terry and Brenda. So we got some good connections over there. And all those in favor of receiving them, indicate by saying amen.
Amen.
I can't hear you under that.
Amen.
I couldn't hear you. Y'all did good. All right, we're going to let you please come by and greet them on your way. I'll be able to look forward to having you officially as members. My prayer is Steve and for Brenda both and for all of us is that we serve the Lord and He's making a difference in our communities. Encourage one another in that. Let's pray together and you come and speak. Lord, we are grateful for the day. We thank you so much for Steve and Brenda and their willingness to step out as an act of faith today in front of this congregation. Lord, I pray your blessing upon them. I pray you would use them in a powerful way in our number to minister to others. And may we minister to them as well, encouraging them by the word and in the things that we do personally with them. Lord, we're so grateful for your presence here today. May we take your word out. May it impact our hearts and our lives with you. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. Amen. Come by, welcome in. You are dismissed.
Amen.